Take your Bibles, open to Mark chapter 15, verse 42. It's only fitting that the sun should shine today, isn't it? Here we are, the day when Jesus rose from the dead, and it should be a good day. It's not a bad day. It's a wonderful day. It's a day of hope. And that's why I want us to see it is, as we look at the burial of Jesus, in these verses here we're going to read, what we're going to see is hope. It's hope. And we're gonna experience some more of that hope when we go into the church service later on. But what we're going to see now is hope. So let's look at Mark chapter 15. Let's look at verse 42, and we'll read down through the end of the chapter. It says this, now when evening had already come, since it was the day of preparation, that is the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a highly regarded member of the council, who was himself looking forward to the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was surprised that he was already dead. He called the centurion and asked him if he had been dead for some time. When Pilate was informed by the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. After Joseph bought a linen cloth and took down the body, he wrapped it in the linen and placed it in a tomb cut out of the rock. Then he rolled a stone across the entrance of the tomb. And Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was placed. And all God's people said, Amen. Yeah. Listen, one of the first things I want to see, Christians have hope, okay, here on this day because Jesus did die and was buried. And he rose again on the third day. But more importantly, what we're going to look at is that he was buried. Now, the importance of that is that all of the Gospels give an account of the burial of Jesus. All of them give space to it. And I think that's important because what it tells us is that what happened was real. It wasn't a made-up story. It was real. He was buried. He was put into a grave. They rolled the stone in front of it. All right? So Jesus really and truly died. That's important. I mean, it's all part of the process. If he really did die, there were those who wanted to say that Jesus really didn't die. And that, you know, it was all a fake. And we're going to hear more about that. I'm not going to take any more. Pastor Joe's going to talk about that. But they want to say it was a fake, that maybe Jesus was just faking it, and they removed him at the last minute, and someone else took his place. And it's not true. Jesus died. In fact, they call it the day of preparation, because it was the day before the Sabbath. Now, as I understand this, Joe and I have talked a little bit about this, that would have been Friday night, okay? And probably when they took Jesus down off the cross, it would have been about an hour or two before dark, because that's when the new day began. So they had to take him down. Deuteronomy 21 is clear. It says, if a man guilty of a capital offense is put to death and his body is hung on a tree, you must not leave his body on the tree overnight. Be sure to bury him that same day. You must not desecrate the land. And so it was important to get him down. The interesting thing is that Joseph of Arimathea is the one that's going to do this. We're going to talk about him in a minute. But I want to drive home the point. Again, what we're celebrating today, we're going to talk more about this in a little bit, it's real. It's real. It really happened. Jesus is alive, and he's at the right hand of the Father now because he went to the cross and died for us, and they buried him to show that it was real. But he didn't stay there. He rose again. So it's important for us. This is a day of hope. This is a day for us to rejoice and be glad in. And that's what we were singing about. So we want to look secondly, okay, that not only was it a day in which Christians can have hope because Jesus was buried and he rose again, but Christians have hope because the same power that raised Jesus from the dead is at work in all believers. I mean, when you look here at what takes place in the passage that I was given, he's buried. You got Joseph of Arimathea that comes to get him, and he spends a lot of time talking about him. And we see the power of God at work in Joseph. Because it says here, if you look at verse 43, it says, Joseph of Arimathea, a highly regarded member of the council. So he was a part of the Sanhedrin council. When they met, we're not sure if Joseph was there, whether he voted or not, okay? But he was part of that council. Surely if he was there, he would not have voted to put Jesus to death because he knew he was an innocent man. But he was there nevertheless. He's part of that council. And so there was a lot of pressure on him. When you think about it here, when it says that he went boldly to Pilate, he really did. Because it wasn't the normal thing for a wealthy man of that kind of status to go to Pilate in public and ask for the body of someone who was murdered or killed for treason. Okay? So So he went, and it says he went boldly. That word there means that he took courage. Courage rose up in him. He dared to go and ask Pilate to do it. Now that gives you some idea of his character. What was at work? Because it also says, it also goes on to talk about him, that he was waiting for the kingdom of God. Now think about that. Here was a man, Joseph of Arimathea, and Nicodemus joined him later. But Nicodemus didn't go to Pilate, as I read scripture. He joined him up later to help bury him. But Joseph of Arimathea went to Pilate because he knew who Jesus was. He says he was waiting for the kingdom of God. And in Joseph's mind, he identified the kingdom of God with Joseph, or with Joseph, with Jesus. Now that's important. How do we understand the kingdom of God? Has the kingdom of God come? Yes, he has. Came in the person of Jesus Christ. Those of us who know Jesus Christ already experience the kingdom of God in our own lives now. It's called the reign and rule of Christ in our hearts. All right? That's the kingdom of God. It has come. It has come. Jesus said when he was casting out demons, he was accused of casting out demons in the name of Beelzebub. He said, listen, if I cast out demons, he said, it is because the kingdom of God has come. It's not anything demonic. He said, it is because the kingdom of God has come. It is here. It was here in the person of Jesus Christ, and it comes now as we get saved, as we come into a personal relationship with him, and he takes up residence in us, and he is our Lord and our Savior. That is the kingdom of God. But it doesn't end there. You already, but not yet, talk. We are looking forward to that kingdom of God, the consummation of that kingdom. That's what this day represents. It represents not only the salvation of mankind, but it represents the coming of the kingdom in the future. And the consummation of that kingdom. It gives us hope. It gives us purpose. It didn't just end with Jesus. It didn't end with Jesus being put in the grave. He rose again. And it didn't end with just his resurrection and him going to heaven and being at the right hand of the Father. It is that he is coming back for those of us who belong to him. And that's good news, isn't it? That gives us hope. That gives us reason to live every day. It gives us purpose. We have something to do. The thing that we have to do is to talk to others and share with them the good news about the kingdom of God, that the kingdom of God has come. All right? And we see that in Joseph of Arimathea. Now, I want you to know, he couldn't have done this on his own. He couldn't have done this in his own strength. All right? I mean, you talk about peer pressure. There was peer pressure. All right? He felt it. He knew it. And going in public to take down a dead body of someone who was given for treason, he couldn't have done that. But because he knew that what was at stake here, because he knew who Jesus was, and because God was at work in him, he was enabled to do it. So you and I can do the same thing. When God calls us to do something, when we have opportunity to witness to somebody, we can do it. Doesn't mean that it's not going to be scary. Doesn't mean that sometimes we might not be a little bit intimidated to go do it. But nevertheless, the power of God at work in you and at work in me will give us that strength, enable us to do it just like it did for Joseph of Arimathea. We can do it. Joseph of Arimathea did it. He could do it. A wealthy man like this. You remember what Jesus said about wealthy men, didn't you? Remember what Mark, we already read it in Mark, and every other gospel said the same thing. He said, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter heaven. Think about that. Think about that. Jesus also said in Mark, if you remember when that verse, it says, Jesus said, it is difficult for rich people to get saved. It is difficult. Get into the kingdom of God. The reason why it's difficult, folks, is because we've got to come to the end of ourselves and say, God, I need you. Say, God, I can't do it on my own. I can't reconcile this relationship between me and you because there's nothing that I can do to make it right. I keep goofing it up. And Joseph of Arimathea, a very wealthy man, a man of great status, had to come to that point, whether he said it publicly or not, he had to come to that point to say, this man is who he said he is. And therefore, I give my allegiance to him, and that requires me to go get his body and take it down and bury it. So it's a good day. It's a day of hope because Jesus rose from the dead. He was buried, showing that he really died. It is a good day because we can see that the same power that was at work to raise Jesus from the dead is at work in you and me, as it was in Joseph of Arimathea. And we can't miss that. We can't miss that. You know, God is a great God. I mean, he doesn't leave us alone. He gives us. He says, I'm not going to leave you. He says, I'm going to give you my spirit so that you can accomplish what I want you to accomplish. Man, that is good news for you and me. That's good news. We also see here that Pilate was surprised that Jesus had died so quickly. All right? I mean, Pilate, not only when Joseph came, he was surprised, but he also sent the centurion, called him in and said, I want to know, is he really dead? Is he really dead? And the centurion said, yeah, he's really dead. He died already. Because a lot of times from crucifixion, men would hang up there sometimes for days before they would die. And for Jesus, it was just a few hours and he was dead. And so Joseph comes to take him down. Nicodemus joins him. They take him to the grave and they're going to bury him. Okay? And they bring all the things to do that with that they could do as quickly as they could do, because they had to get back home before dark as well in order to observe the Sabbath. Otherwise, they would have been unclean. So Joseph of Arimathea steps out of what he normally would do, takes a chance, and goes and gets the body of Jesus and buries it. Alright? But there's one other thing here as we look at this. And that is this. As Christians, we have hope because we understand the truth. As a result of this, we understand the truth of reality. Okay? We know what reality is all about. There are things that the Bible tells us as absolutes, which are sinful, which do not conform to the character of God. But aside from these, the sovereignty of Christ, the sovereignty of God, is over all of life. Life, death, all of it. He's in control of it all. He masters it. Christianity, then, is not a series of truths to be entered into intellectually. It is there. There is the intellectual side of Christianity. But that's not what Christianity is. Christianity is a relationship with Jesus Christ. Christianity is coming to know that your sins are forgiven. It's not just that I know these truths and that I can answer these questions, that if you give me a test, I can define certain things. That's not what Christianity is all about. And the problem with that is when we reduce it to that as believers, then we see the results of it. We look around the world today to see what's going on, and we have problems, right? Anybody here would say that the world doesn't have problems? We have problems, all right? But I want to propose this. The problems that we have are a result of the church at large. I mean, let's just face it. The church, in my opinion, the church is at the center of history. As the church goes, so goes our culture. Our culture either goes well because we are living as we should be, or it doesn't go well because we're not living as we should be. So see, to understand truth is not the be-all and end-all of things. Because if we understand those truths and then go live a poor Christian life, and we don't do what we're supposed to do, then we suffer as a result of that. There are certain things that happen as a result of that, and we can see that, whether it's in the church at large, or whether it's in our government, or whether it's in the policies that are made, the laws that are made. It's all there. Because you see, the other side, there's only two sides to things. You realize that? There's not a middle ground that we can get on. There's only two sides. There's either what God says and what God says is true, or there's what the world says and what it teaches and it is true. It's one or the other. And they can't be combined in any way. You can't blend them together. Alright? They're in that kind of a stark contrast. They can't come together. And I think that's where our young people struggle these days, because they hear the world saying certain things, they hear Christianity saying certain things, and they don't know what to do. Do I stay over here, or do I go over here? I've got some friends over here. What do I do? Well, you know, how do I understand these issues? And so what they try to do, whatever the issue is, they'll try to blend it together, and you can't do that. You can't serve two masters, is what Jesus said. You got to serve one or the other. And I think that's what this burial reminds us of. Either Jesus rose from the dead, or he didn't. Either he was who he said he was, or he wasn't. And you see it there. As we looked at the Passion Week, we looked at what Jesus went through. You had those who were on the side of what we would call the world side, who didn't believe in who he was, and you had those who did. Right? I mean, there was the two sides. It was there. You had Pilate on the other side asking him questions. He was trying to figure out, which side do I want to be on, you know? Washing his hands, not knowing what to do, having his wife come to him and having the dream saying Jesus is who he is, you know, trying to convince the Jews but couldn't, and then finally giving them up. You had the Jews who didn't believe who he was, and they were on the other side, and they were saying, listen, crucify him. He is not who he says he is. We don't want to believe that. He is not the Son of God. He didn't come to save us. But then you had the disciples, right, and his family. They believed it, right? But where were they in the end? They were gone, didn't they? They were gone. They scattered. They scattered. Okay? And the only one that came out then was Joseph of Arimathea. Think about that. When it was time to bury Jesus, his family, they were at a distance because we'll see Mary and his, you know, his mother Mary, and they were there, but they were there from a distance watching where he was, afraid to come out. Joseph was the only one that came out. And you see, that's kind of where we are. Alright? We either got to stand up and choose the side that we're going to stand on and take a stand for God and let the world know what we believe, or we're going to fall victim and we're going to wind up on the other side. Because bad company corrupts good morals. Alright? Very seldom do we pull ourselves out of that once we get in. They pull us away. And so we've got to be careful. Is this reality or not? Do we understand it, that this is true and that Jesus is who he said he is, and that he's at the right hand of the Father right now, and that one day he will come back? If he is, then we need to give ourselves to him. We need to pursue him with all our might. We need to give it all. We don't need to be pursuing the things of this world. We need to be pursuing him. We need to be chasing after him, because one day it's all going to come to an end and all this stuff is going to get burned up anyway. So why are we wasting our time doing that? Why not chase after things that have eternal significance? So see, we're looking at two different sides here. Two different sides. If we want justice in this world, if we want to see this world change, then we got to be the ones to make the change. Okay? We've got to be the ones to do it. And the way that God always works is through people just like you and me. And as we take a stand for what is right, then God begins to move and do some things. Wouldn't it be great if God would bring revival to the United States? Wouldn't it be great if God would pour out his Spirit in a big way so that we could see some change that is really, really big, something that's out of the ordinary, something that we can't take credit for, but something that only God would do? What he's going to do, he's going to start with you and me. That's the way it starts. Not just intellectually, but knowing it to be true and responding to that. That's the only way we're going to see change take place. Man is made in the image of God, right? And therefore, being made in the image of God, we treat each other differently. We treat each other with dignity and respect. So when we look at this, it says, after Joseph bought a linen cloth, took down the body, he wrapped it in the linen, placed it in the tomb cut out of a rock. And then he rolled a stone across the entrance of the tomb. When we go into the next service, we've got to ask ourselves a question. Did this really happen? See? Can God act outside of what is the norm? And the answer to that is yes. And if he did, then there's been a... then there's good news for us. And there's good news for us. See, things don't have to stay the way they are. Then you got to ask yourself, what is it that God wants me to do? What is my purpose? If Christ is going to come back, how am I going to serve his kingdom from now until the time he comes back? Or until now, until the time I die? We just sang the song that said, when I come to die, give me Jesus. When I come to die. None of us have experienced death. Right? Has anyone experienced death? If you have, Joe would like to talk to you. Pastor Joe. And we can go from there. But nobody has. We don't know what that experience is like. But we know that Jesus did. And we know that he's waiting for us in heaven for that time when we go home to be with him. That's why we see it as a homecoming. You see, the world sees death as the end of all things. The world sees death as the end of everything that goes on, that your purpose, that there was no purpose, that you just die and you just kind of meld into the universe, and that's just kind of it. It's all over. But for the Christian, it's not true. We know. We know we have his Spirit living in us, and it should change us. It should change us. We should become like Christ. Christ who came and gave himself on our behalf. Christ who took upon himself humanity. Christ who gave up all that he had in order to come down here, in order to become like man, to die on the cross so that we might become like him. That's what he did. The Bible says he humbled himself even to the point of death. Alright? He was willing to let God be in control and trust him to do it even to the point of death. my question is, are we? As the sun pops up and we see the beauty of the day, are we willing to say, God, this is your day. Do with me as you see fit. You're in control of my life. I'm not. Take it and use it for your glory. Are we willing to say that and really mean it? That's one thing to say it, another thing to sing the songs, but do we really mean it? Do we really mean it? Again, it's not just about knowing some things. Sometimes we go to Bible conferences and Bible studies so we can learn new things, and that's all we want to do. It's not just about the intellectual pursuit. It's what do you do with those truths when they're done? Are you living on those truths? See, that's where you see it. Do I trust God enough to take His word at face value and do it? Do I take God at His word at face value to tell someone else that, listen, what happened to me is real and it can happen to you, whether they reject us or not? The world's not going to be in love with us. You do realize that. All right, this is not a time to try and win friends and influence people by sharing the gospel. The Bible says all they that live godly will what? Suffer persecution. Now, we don't suffer much over here in the United States, at least not yet. About the worst that we suffer is rejection from those around us. They may make fun of us a little bit, but nevertheless, we got to get the word out. We got to tell people about Jesus. We got to let them know that the grave is empty, that Jesus really died, they buried him, and that he rose again on the third day. That's what the world needs to hear. You know, that's what they need to hear. That will solve all their problems, won't it? It really will. I mean, it may not be a cure-all, may not get, but it's going to give them the grace they need to see it through every day, no matter what comes. Because we really don't ever lose all our problems, do we? Is anyone problem-free? If you are, I want to sit down with you. We'll write a book, and we'll make a million, and we'll go from there. Because no one's problem-free. We all have problems. We all suffer at some point. That's just the way life is, okay? But nevertheless, God is there to lead us there. See, that's the good news. God is alive. The world has no hope. It's looking for hope, but it has no hope. We have the hope, and they're waiting for us to come and tell them the good news of the gospel. And it takes men like Joseph of Arimathea, who was willing to step out of his comfort zone and to move into an area to go get the body of Jesus. It takes men like that and women like that to be able to make a difference in this world. And so I think that's my challenge today, is that we have hope because Jesus rose from the dead. We have hope because what we read is true. It's not just a story. It's not a myth. It's not a fable. It's true. We have hope because that same power that raised Jesus from the dead is the same power that works in you and me. And if we but let God work in us, let His Spirit work in us and on us and through us, then we can see God make a difference in our community right here. Let's just start right here in our community. Let's see God save some people. Let's see God make some changes in lives. So, when we look, there's just one more verse. It says, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Jesus, saw where the body was placed. Again, that is just affirmation that what took place was real. I mean, can you imagine somebody, the church at large, making up a story like this? Can you imagine them putting a rich person who's come, a rich, wealthy Jew to come and get the body down off the cross? They wouldn't have come up with that kind of story. They wouldn't have done it. All right? It had to be true. This has to be real. So, what are you going to do about it? How are you going to respond to what Jesus did? Are you going to allow Him to work in you and on you and through you to make change? Or are you just going to make it an intellectual thing? Man, the world needs us to step forward, to be different, to be willing to stand before them and to say, listen, I've got the answer. I've got the answer to what ails you. And it's not what you think, but it's in the person of Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for the day. We thank you for the hope that you have given us through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you that this is not just a cleverly devised fable or myth, but Father, that it is real. And we thank you that Jesus is at your right hand now. Father, we pray that you would pour out your Spirit upon us, that you use this time today to encourage us, to call us forward, to give us strength and grace so that we might go forward and share the good news with those we come in contact with. And we'll give you all the praise and the glory now. In Jesus' name, amen. Mm-hmm.